Welcome to the Baltic University and on your course, Peoples of the Baltic. 2 years ago, we were dealing with the environmental situation of the Baltic region. This time, we will deal with ourselves and the societies, that is, the peoples of the Baltic. We are going to broadcast to you 8 times from the entire Baltic region and to the entire Baltic region. To be able to do this, we have assembled quite a complex team. Today, it is from Visby on Gotland. You can see here Team Hjelbe Production, who is actually doing the TV production itself, and then we use the Swedish Space Corporation facilities to uplink to the Tele-X satellite, from which the signal goes back into your satellite dishes and into your TV sets. So if you come here, you can see all the equipment that's necessary for such a TV production. Actually, there are 13 people in the team that is doing this. Today we are going to be in the medieval cellar called Klimatis in the center of Visby. So it's going to be almost like a medieval festival. So welcome in. Here is a lot of students. There are the experts that will discuss the questions we are dealing with today. So please come in. The person who has been doing the scientific coordination of this first session is Charles Westin, who is an associate professor of Stockholm University. Charles, what are we going to talk about today?
We're going to talk about the Baltic region as a meeting place of languages, of cultures, and of religion.
So this is going to be the very start of the peoples of the Baltic. Perhaps we should have been a cave instead, with the hides on us.
No, I think this is quite an appropriate setting.
Well, we also have a couple of students right here dressed up in medieval clothing, and you are?
My name is Justas Pipinis, and I am from Lithuania.
But you are here in Visby?
Yes, at the moment I am studying economics here in Visby.
Very good. And you are?
My name is Åsa Nilsson.
So you are also, both of you, studying this course. What do you hope that you will learn, or what are your expectations?
Oh, we live so close to each other here in the Baltic region, but we know so little about each other. I hope this course will provide us with more information.
That's certainly what we hope to do, and you, Åsa?
Of course. I want to know more about the eastern regions, especially about the culture. I think that's my...
So the eastern students want to know more about the westerners, and the westerners more about the easterners. That's what it's all about, the Baltic University, of course. Charles, these are just two of thousands of students that are listening to us right now. How do you think about that?
Well, it's exciting having all these students all around the Baltic region listening and taking part in this course, this program. It's a good experience for us all, I think.
We will show a map that is showing also who is actually taking part in this. It's a setup of no less than 14 countries. If we take it clockwise, you have Finland, the Western Russia, with Karelia, of course, Kaliningrad, and then Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, a large part of Belarus, and then Poland, Germany, Denmark, and Sweden. So in addition to these 10 in the middle of the region, so to speak, you have another 4 at the rim, that is Western Ukraine, the northern part of Czech and Slovak republics, and some students also in Norway. These countries make up what is called the drainage basin of the Baltic Sea. And the Baltic Sea is receiving water from the region that is marked with white here. So it's a natural region in many ways, also historically, culturally, and that is, of course, the basis of what we are doing right here. We have no less than about 120 universities in the region who take part in this program now. You see they are distributed all over the region, from the north end to down to Czech and Slovak republics, actually. So on many of these places that are shown, there are 4 and 5 universities who take part. So all of you sitting out there, you are welcome to this session. I will tell you what we are going to discuss today. We will start with the very first The very first settlers that came here, first the living conditions, then the settlers, then the peoples and languages of the region, then the rites and traditions that have developed here. So that's the first 45 minutes. Then there is a break of 50 minutes. We will show some material there, but there certainly is an occasion for you to stretch your legs and talk to your neighbor. Then there will be another 45 minutes that will deal with the religions in the region, the cultures, communication and trade, and the origins of the states. So that's the program we have ahead of us. And Charles, where do you think we should start?
We'll start by looking at the landscape, by describing it.
Nowhere else in Europe do we find the transition between sea and land as gradual as it is in the Baltic. The Danish Isles and Sounds represent one instance of this interplay between land and sea. The archipelagos of Finland and Sweden, differing greatly from the Danish Isles as to geological structure, are another instance of the transition of sea into land and land into sea. The coasts by Gdansk and Kaliningrad display yet another form of transition between land and sea, here in the form of sand reefs and longshore bars. There are tens of thousands of islands in the Baltic, ranging from small skerries of some 1,000 square meters to the largest islands, Shetland, Bornholm, Gotland, Öland, Åland, Saaremaa and Hiiumaa. Islands provide an environment that is different for human societies than the mainland. They withstand change and novelties. Several major islands of the Baltic confirm this, having been ethnically distinct communities. In modern times, young people have emigrated to the better job opportunities found on the mainland. This drain of the population has skewed the demographic distribution. Peninsulas represent a particular kind of land surrounded on three sides by the sea. This means that the vital force of the sea carries its weight far into the land of the peninsula, not only in a metaphorical sense. Conditions of living on continental mainlands differ from those on islands. Economical factors, communications, means of subsistence all come into play in molding the mentality of mainlanders different to that of islanders. Fertile plains promote large-scale land ownership, in contrast to agricultural enterprises in mountainous regions or in moraine-type forests, as in Finland and Sweden. Feudalism was a factor of importance in Russia, the Baltic states, Poland, Germany, and even in Denmark, but not in Sweden or Finland, where there is a long tradition of free peasants. Fertile plains tend to become densely populated and thus the kernel of economically and militarily strong central governments. Territorial minorities of the plains tend to become assimilated into majority populations as one group gets the upper hand. Due to the homogeneity of the land, plains tend to be dominated by one particular mode of agriculture, thus rendering it difficult for minorities to maintain their specific economic independence. Economic independence is usually a condition for ethnic independence. People living in forest and mountain regions tend to conserve traditional ways of life to a larger extent than those living on plains. These regions usually presuppose harsher living conditions than plains. They consist primarily of unproductive land, either because it is barren or because it is difficult of access. Mountain regions often serve as places of refuge for ethnic minorities, making these regions into a mosaic of small worlds.
You see, also I now got some medieval clothing, so I can fit into this company. The core message of this production was, of course, that there is a correlation between the landscape, the physical structure, and the societies that develop in these landscapes. But I guess there are exceptions, Charles.
Yes, there are several exceptions, of course. One of the most important ones is that the Danish isles of Sjælland and Fyn and the other central islands of Denmark are not anything else but the center of the Danish state. They're not minority places. They're center of the Baltic region in many respects, and not periphery. Another exception that we have to point out is that Latvians and Lithuanians have managed to preserve their languages despite the fact that they are living on great plains. And so it's difficult to make generalizations here. We do have also exceptions.
And then we should say that, of course, the Baltic landscape have changed extremely dramatically the last few thousand years, because 10,000 years ago there was the inland ice on the island of Gotland. When the inland ice disappeared, melted away, there has been a land uprise, and this uprise is still quite important in northern part of the region. We will show you animated graphics that show this. And please look very carefully at the northern end and see what is in the beginning blue, that is water, becomes green, that is land. So this process we can see now. It's quite difficult but try to follow. In the northern end, it's the most important part where you have more land being developed. And actually what is going to happen in 1,000 years from now is that the Botnian Bay will become a lake, like Lake Ladoga, for example.
Another process is found in the southern end of the region. There, kilometers of sandy beaches are removed or formed during the years. The dunes of Kaliningrad is a very good example.
The long 140 kilometers of the southeastern part of the Baltic Sea coast, the lands of the Kaliningrad region of Russia is situated. It is just 15,000 square kilometers. But natural wealth of this small part of land is extremely rich and varied. And it is not surprising, as here the sea and the land meet. Here it is a coastline. Different natural processes interact. During the last several thousand years, about 6-7, the seaside of land sinks, about 3 or 5 centimeters per century. But that the waves wash away the coast, and the sea boat destroying recedes on 50 centimeters per year in average. Waves take huge mass of the sand, and seaside currents carry it along the north coast to the east and northeast, and along the west coast to the south. Sandy beaches of 20, 60 meters wide are formed. About 6-7 years ago, these deposits, together with mass of hard material bringing by Wisla and Neman rivers, made two sandy spits, Kurshan and Wisling. The sand hills, dunes, reaching the height 60-70 meters, appeared on their surface under the influence of the prevailing western winds.
Please, Lucia.
When the settlers first arrived here 10 to 12,000 years ago, they found a landscape that was the margin of a vast expanse of inland ice. And geographers have been trying to figure out the melting pace of this ice. And I think we should now see a computer graphics of this scheme.
Ice. From the maximum position some 20,000 years ago, the ice retreated, first slowly, then faster. At the same time, our Stone Age ancestors advanced northwards, hunting reindeer and other animals not far from the ice margin. They often lived by the sea, and their dwellings may be found on the contemporary beach berms. After a short re-advance, between 12 and 10,000 years ago, the ice quickly disappeared. By 8,000 years before present, there was no inland ice left.
The open coast of Gotland is formed by wind and waves. But Gotland itself is due to land uplift. So when we go into the city and look, for instance, at the medieval harbor down here, it's about 4 or 5 meters above the sea level today. And beyond the town wall, the town rises, and up on the marketplace, some 20 meters above the sea level today, you'll find a Stone Age settlement from, say, about 2,000 years BC. I'm coming and walking up from the shoreline at the time when the waves of the Baltic Sea were rolling in about here. And on the main square, we had that Stone Age settlement, a rather large one, about 2 hectares, say some 2-3 meters beneath the pavement today. In the front of the main square, we have a church ruin from the Franciscan order, which settled here in the beginning of the 13th century. Some 2 meters under my feet, the archaeologists have found a Stone Age settlement. It was a perfect situation for the Stone Age man, with a shore, fishing and so forth, quite close, and small streams running from the cliff around here with fresh water. An excellent situation, I would say.
And even before these dramatic events on Gotland, that is when the ice was still on Gotland, the first settlers came to the Baltic region, and in all likelihood they were the Sami.
It seems reasonable to assume that the Sami represent an indigenous people in northern Scandinavia. Ancestors of the present Sami population may have been present in this region ever since the inland ice started to melt. There is evidence of human presence north of the ice sheet already 10,000 years ago, on the fringe of the Arctic basin. These people may have been the ancestors of the Sami. One theory is that the Sami originated in the northern regions of present Russia, possibly as far east as the Ural Mountains. At some stage, they settled in the region of the Gulf of Finland. As Finnish tribes eventually migrated into the territory of present-day Karelia and Finland, these southern Sami were driven north to their present habitat. The Sami belong to the Finno-Ugric language group. In the vast expanses of northern Russia, a number of minorities have existed speaking Finno-Ugric languages. There's reason to believe that these Finno-Ugric groups represent languages that were once widely spread in the northern stretches of present-day Russia.
We have a Finno-Ugric friend here, actually, Vladimir Koko from St. Petersburg, and I'm sure you want to comment on this.
Thank you. Really, Proto-Finno-Ugrians came to the Baltic region somewhere from the Urals. It was not a simple migration, but a steady expansion. The distribution of Finno-Ugric languages today is shown in blue on this map. Finno-Ugric languages, as you know, are very unique. They don't belong to an Indo-European linguistic family. And here must be some more blue color in the basin of Volga River. You see that till nowadays, different Finnish languages speaking population is widely presented in the whole Northern Europe and even in Northern Siberia.
Mm. We also have a map that is showing where one expects that the Sami settled when they first came, when this large part of the inland ice was still here.
Yeah, here it is. Genetically, Sami people differs much from Finns, but as it seems, they adopted once the language from Proto-Finnish majority. While Proto-Finns migrated far and far west, the Sami people migrated north with their reindeers following the tundra climate during the glaciification.
And it's not only the Sami people where you have traces, but also Indo-Europeans.
Yeah. Remains of early settlers have been found also in other places. Research in dealing with a genotype of them are going on at Vilnius University.
Here you can see a map illustrating how first inhabitants in East Baltic region appear. From west and south direction, they came to the Daugava and Nemunas river area in East Baltic about 10 millennia before Christ. This time, ice sheet covered Scandinavian countries, Scandinavian region, and first reindeer hunters became in this region.
These people came from somewhere from south and southwest of Europe. Here you can see skull of the first inhabitant of Lithuania. It is dated about 10,000 years old. And just on my side, you can see plastic reconstruction, a portrait of a gentleman, of one of first inhabitants, who lived here about 10 to 12,000 years ago. When Indo-Europeans came into recent days Lithuania and Latvia region, they partially assimilated, partially expelled this indigenous pre-Indo-European population. And synthetic culture, Pamarių culture, was formed. At the same time, synthetic, hybrid, anthropological type of people emerged. Now I'm holding the skull of a woman who lived about 5,000 years ago. I can say this is my true ancestor, lady, and here is her plastic reconstruction. I should repeat that these events, coming of Indo-Europeans, took place about 4,000 years ago, and later on there were no major people movement in our region. So from that period, we, Lithuanians, Latvians, and ancient Prussians, we are settled permanently on the southeast Baltic coast.
Genetic aspects of contacts between different cultures with some linguistic references are presented also in the next video, contribution from Turku.
The Finnish experts of genetics can tell us that about 75% of the genes of the Finns are Western or Indo-European. They also say that about 25% of our genes are Eastern, which means that we also have Mongoloid features. You may have noticed that Finns have higher cheekbones than most of Europeans. We are maybe not so tall as the Swedes are. These features come from the East. The Indo-Europeans who have come to Finland during about 4,000 years have come to our coasts in small groups. They have settled down here, they have married local people, and gradually they have assimilated to the local people. They have accepted the local language also. But they have always brought here their own Indo-European or Western genes. So the gradualness, or the fact that they came here in small groups, is, I think, the explanation to this contradiction, so to say. In the present day Finnish language, you can still see that there were Balts who came here during the War Axe period, because we have about 200 old Baltic loanwords. We can also see that the Proto-Germanic people came here about 3,000 years ago and 2,000 years ago, because we have today in the Finnish language about 500 Proto-Germanic loanwords. Of course, later, about 800 years ago and 400 years ago, we had many Swedes who came to our coasts. The Swedish kings in Stockholm and central Sweden thought that it was safer for the seafarers of Sweden to have people who spoke Swedish on the coasts of Finland and Estonia. So actually the same process is still going on. There, even today, are so-called Indo-European people on the coasts and more local or original people in central parts of the country.
Well, I think that when we take a look at human behavior, you can't really say the genes have a label on them. You have the genotype and the phenotype, that which is the composition and then the physical expression of that in the phenotype. You also have language, you have behavior, and more important than that, you have identity. What do people call themselves? And the whole field of anthropology or cultural anthropology has developed because people are trying to account for human uniformity and diversity, or in plain English, figure out why people and how people are alike and different. Charles, what about that?
Well, today, ethnicity is a very important factor. We see it in the tragic war in Bosnia, for instance. Ethnicity is a strong force of mobilization, of identity. There's controversy about what ethnicity is. There's different approaches. One approach focuses on the situation, on labeling, mm-hmm. and these sort of things. Another approach focuses on ethnicity as a primordial force. It's deep down. One theory is it's about extended kinship. Sociobiologists bring up that thread. Another controversial theory is that it's related to language. There are many other aspects of ethnicity that are important, but we won't have time to go in depth here in this discussion, but perhaps we should mention such things as territory, culture, religion, boundaries of various mm-hmm. kinds.
Yes, and also language. What about the Finno-Ugrics?
For Ingrian Finns, whom I belong to, most important are Finnish language and Lutheran religion. These two separate us from the surrounding Russian majority. Mm-hmm.
And language has always been used to trace migration patterns. It's one of the easiest things to do. And so when the Germanic and the Slavic-speaking peoples came into Northern Europe, they basically came into a very sparsely inhabited area. And in this inhabited area, we can trace their comings and their goings. Why? Because they speak a certain language or a dialect of that language. And what we have here in front of us now are two videos showing the dispersal of the language in this area.
The Germanic languages represent the most extensive branch of the Indo-European languages. The term Germanic was assigned to the languages spoken by the Germanic peoples inhabiting the country north of the Roman Empire in Central and Eastern Europe. Peoples speaking a Proto-Germanic language settled on the southwestern shores of the Baltic, crossing the sea to the southern tip of the Scandinavian peninsula, when agriculture was introduced in the region some 3,000 years ago. Peasant populations spread north along the coasts, replacing the indigenous Sami. The Germanic languages are divided into three branches, West Germanic, North Germanic, and East Germanic, which is now extinct. Within the Baltic region, West Germanic is represented by Low German and Yiddish. Low German is the tongue spoken in the northern part of present-day Germany. Yiddish was spoken by the Jewry of Eastern Europe. It developed late in history out of the German that was spoken by the Jewry of Poland, Lithuania, and Russia. It incorporated a good deal of Slavic and Hebrew vocabulary. Due to the Nazi extermination policies directed at the Jewish people, it is more or less extinct in the Baltic region nowadays. The North Germanic languages divide into an Eastern and a Western branch. Norwegian belongs to the Western branch together with Icelandic. Danish, Swedish, and Gotlandic all belong to the Eastern one. The latter three developed as separate languages at the onset of the Viking era in the 9th century. Since the 10th century, literary forms of these languages are found in the inscriptions on runestones. Major Slavic languages in the Baltic region are Russian, Belarusian, Ukrainian, Polish, Czechish, and Slovakian. Russian is the native language of well over 150 million people and is understood by many more. There are Slavic minority languages as well. In prehistoric times, the tribes speaking Proto-Slavic languages inhabited a region roughly coinciding with present-day northern Ukraine and southern Belarus. At the time of the Great Migration, 4th to 8th centuries AD, Slavic tribes migrated south, west, and north. The Eastern Slavs, ancestors of the Russians and Ukrainians, encountered and assimilated Baltic and Finnish-speaking tribes as they spread north. The Western Slavs migrated to the southern shores of the Baltic. The Eastern Slavs adopted Christianity from Byzantium in 988 AD, whereas the Western Slavs came under the influence of the Roman Church. With the expansion of Tsarist Russia, a Russification policy was directed at Finno-Ugric tribes to the north and at Ukrainian and Belarusian-speaking populations in the south. Russification continued during most of the Soviet period. Non-Slavic speaking peoples within the Soviet Union were to become bilingual. Eventually, this policy was conducive to the downfall of the Soviet Union. Polish is the Slavic language with the longest unbroken tradition. One reason for this was that Latin was the language of the church, thus it never interfered with popular language.
Lithuanian is my native language, and it's the most conservative of all the Indo-European languages, or so say the scholars. Latvian is a much more modern form of Lithuanian, but both of these languages are the remnants of a very large family of Indo-European languages that are surrounded by the others.
Baltic languages form a separate group within the Indo-European language family. This group was formed at least 2,000 years before Christ. Just two living languages belong to this group, Latvian and Lithuanian. The third leaf of this branch, Prussian, is a dead language, having been extinct in the 17th century. Nowadays, there are about 2 million speakers of Latvian and about 3 million speakers of Lithuanian in the whole world. At the beginning, you heard the magic Latvian fire words. But now, an example of Lithuanian folklore. Baltic languages, especially Lithuanian, have been extremely conservative and preserved a lot of old forms and sounds of Indo-European parent language, more than any other living Indo-European language. We have words in which all the sounds are thousands of years old. And now, an example of Latvian dialects. Please pay attention to sounds, especially vowels,
and intonations in long syllables. Perhaps it's a little bit like the language spoken by our predecessors more than 4,000 years ago. Es piedzimu māmiņai, kad dziedāja lakstīgala. Netrūks dziesmu man dziedot, ne valodu runājot.
One question that has been a puzzle is why the Indo-European languages have existed all over Europe, apart from the Finno-Ugric languages, and all the way down to northern India. One theory that is coming up nowadays is that the spread of Indo-European languages was associated to the new economy that came with agriculture, and so the Indo-European languages have spread when agriculture was introduced. It was a gradual process, and it started about 10,000 years ago. It reached the Baltic region roughly about 4,000 years ago.
This language tree, could we see it? Shows that there are many well-diversified Baltic Finnish languages. And looking back to a geographic distribution of them, it's important to say that neighboring Finnish languages are mutually understandable, but located geographically far one from another are not.
The issue also is who wrote down the language, because whoever wrote the definitive work of that particular language is the one that is considered the standard or the right way to speak. And in that way, you have regional dialects that are considered improper or not the right way to speak. Another standardization, of course, is the media. What is the language that you hear most frequently? And then what is the language that the teachers teach in school? So the standardization of a language occurs through many different processes and continues as we move into the world of communications and media as well.
We can also unfortunately follow a disappearing of languages nowadays. For example, there are two Baltic Finnish languages, both spoken by 20 or 30 peoples only. One is Livonian in Latvia and another Votic in Russia, nearby Estonian boundary.
Well, I'm very interested in Gotlandic because now that we are in Gotland, we see all of the remnants of Gotlandic culture, but is the language still there? Does it still exist? And Åsa, do you speak Gotlandic?
I can speak it, but I don't use it very much. I mean, just if I meet people that speak Gotlandic, I can. I have to be in it for a while. Mm-hmm.
But can you sing something in Gotlandic for us?
Mm-hmm. I sing a small part of a song in Gotlandic for you. Husre Nils har fått lite att göra, han går på garden och störtar stang. Åh, dränga, borget fere, att åh, gatgrindig är för trang. Våga klucka när på stranden, mellom steina, bläcka värpar upp, att tuar bakom einar upp på backa, sta sigdes håp och skobbar rumpo i motentall.
Beautiful, thank you very much. One of the things we have to remember is that we have long and strong oral traditions, and songs are a very, very good way of communicating ancient rhythms and ancient sounds. We also have rituals, and we have rituals that follow the cycle of the year. I know that in Latvia there is a ritual called Metanis, which comes to the welcoming of the sun in the spring. Do we have such a ritual in Lithuania, Juste?
Oh, yes, we do. We have Užgavėnės in spring, and we have Joninės in midsummer. Mm-hmm.
And do we have something like that in Gotland?
Yes, in the spring we have Valborg, and in the summer, midsummer. Mm-hmm.
And I think it is these rituals with the ancient songs and dances that perhaps we could take a look at the Latvian greeting of the sun.
Troja on me
So there we have very typical festivity of the Latvians. And do you use fire also in Lithuania?
Oh.
We certainly do in Swedish. When, what did you call it now? We have to remind the others what's the spring festivity that uses fire.
We call it Valborg.
Yeah, so we do have some pictures from Valborg also. It's interesting to see that it's very similar. So let's look at that. So Charles, do you see any kind of, say, scientific explanation to all this? Do you see a pattern, being a scientist?
Well, there is one thing that is essential to point out, I think, and that in these northern countries, light is a very essential thing that affects people's moods, and I think in the continuation of that, it affects probably mentalities. In Southern Europe, you don't have the same focus on light. You have it on other things, on the harvesting of grapes and the process of producing wine, for instance.
So light is important not only for the spring when the light returns, but also in the midsummer when there is the maximum amount of light. Now, so we have talked about the number of things that's common to the region, and of course others that are not, that are very different in different parts of the region. But how would you sum up this? What is the commonality of the Baltic region? Lucia, do you have a comment on this?
Well, I think you have to take a look at the people in their ecosystem. Mm-hmm. You have to take a look at indigenous cultures and then the influence of Christianity, the influence of their separation through their trade and also through the development of the industries. And I think that in any analysis, you have to take a look at how do people place themselves in time and space. What gives them meaning? What gives them a sense of reality? And then what do they do to pass that on to the next generation? And that is exactly what we call culture.
So you would stress very much the soft part of this, the social patterns, the behavioral part of it. But what about the biological one? Is that not of importance? Charles, do you think it is?
No, I don't think the biological part is important. I think we are very similar in that respect. But there has been a cultural divide between the East and the West that goes back at least 1,000 years or more. It's the difference between Eastern Christianity and Western Christianity.
So we'll certainly come back to that aspect after the break, but now let's stretch our legs and take a little break.
The Gotlandic picture stones dates from the 5th century, that is the migration period, and onwards until the middle part of the 11th century. The earliest types of stones have this circle depicted on them, a circle which can be filled with different type of patterns. We find the same symbol already in the early Bronze Age cultures down in the Mediterranean area and all over Europe. In most cultures, this symbol is interpreted as a symbol of the sun, that is, the sun as a symbol of resurrection. We find this symbol on the Gotlandic stones until about 650, or the middle part, the beginning of the 7th century. By then, it disappears totally, and we have instead other types of symbols which can be connected with the Nordic Asa religion. It's not surprising that the symbol of a sun survived longer in the Nordic area than it did in the Mediterranean area or is in Southern Europe because of the darkness the long dark winter periods up here in Scandinavia. It's not only the symbol of the sun that were depicted in the early period. We also have already in the 5th century the snakes, as you can see on this one, and we have these beautiful large rowing boats. Later on, they were replaced by other types of ships, most of all sailing ships. The snakes also survived into the Asa religion period. In that period, we have several stones with only snakes depicted on them. But the sun symbol disappears and never came back again.
Up to the middle of the 10th century, religious practice in the Baltic region was mainly pagan. Many gods, several of them local, were worshipped. In the beginning of the 11th century, Old Uppsala was made center of heathendom and resistance against Christianity. Here we find the burial mounds of Iron Age kings and the legendary heathen temple. Later on, this very place was made the center of the church and seat of the Swedish archbishop.
Christianity approached the regions from three directions. The German king and bishops in the Ottonian Empire sent missionaries towards Czechia, Poland, and Denmark. The Danish king was baptized in 952. A first bishop's seat was established in Poznan in 966. A second missionary wave came from England, reaching Norway and Sweden. The Swedish king was baptized in the year 1000. The third wave originated in Constantinople and the Byzantine Empire. The wave of influence followed the old Viking routes to Kiev and later to Novgorod. Grand Duke Vladimir of Kiev adopted the Greek form of Christianity in 988. As a consequence, an east-west divide developed. In the west, Roman influence with Latin language and letters, and in the east, influence from Constantinople and Church Slavic and Cyrillic letters, a pattern that we still live with. Pressures from Islam and Judaism were too weak to play a role.
Christianization was sometimes a rather brutal affair. This could happen when a king was baptized, probably often as a political decision. There was, however, also another development, slow but important, converting old traditions and ceremonies into Christian ones. That happened, for instance, in Lithuania, when the fertile goddess Semina was followed by Saint Mary. In Sweden, we see how the hammer of the god Thor was followed by the Christian cross.
Christianization continued using means both of war and peace. The Danish destroyed the famous pagan temple in Arkona in 1169, and then continued to Christianize Estonia. The Swedish king, likewise, attacked Finland, and the German knights established themselves in Livonia and East Prussia as the German orders. Of course, all these crusades or military enterprises were as well colonization. Lithuania was included in the Western Christian tradition when Grand Duke Jogalia married a Polish princess in 1384. Lithuania was thus the last part to turn Christian. Important contributions of religious spirituality were added when the monastic orders of monks and nuns established themselves in the region. Cloisters were built by the Cistercians in rural settings. Franciscans and Dominicans established their centers in the cities. In the end of the 14th century, the Baltic region gave its own contributions, the Brigittines. A chain of cloisters of this order, founded by the Swedish Saint Birgitta, was established around the Baltic, often named after Saint Mary.
Right now, I'm standing under the cupola of St. Laurentius Church in central Visby. The church seemed to indicate some traits from Orthodox churches, and it is an equal armed cross with an inscribed quadrant. The church wasn't completed in the original shape, but it seemed to have been burnt, and the central tower was moved to a normal western tower in that in this direction. But the church indicates, and the architecture, very strong connections with Russia. And I think it has been a church for the Russian merchants in Visby. But let's hear more about that from a scholar from St. Petersburg.
In the Baltic region, in its eastern part, Orthodoxy appeared in the end of the 10th century and was influenced by the Byzantine Empire. The main religion centers here were Novgorod, Polotsk, and Vladimir Volinsky. Christening of some Baltic tribes in Estland, Latgalia, Livonia began in the 11th century, and Novgorod's missionaries took an important part in this process. One of the important features of Orthodoxy is the monasticism. First Orthodox monastery appeared here in the 10th century, and there were more than 30 ones in the end of the 12th century, including 16 of them in Novgorod. In the beginning of the 20th century, it was a small abbey in the main, with the exception of Valam and Konovits monastery on the Ladoga Lake, some monasteries in St. Petersburg and Novgorod, where hundreds of people lived. Abbeys were always centers of charity. They organized school, opened hospitals, shelters, and so on. Now some words about modern Russian Orthodoxy. I have to attract your attention to intensive changes of this situation. In the Baltic region, there are about 20 abbeys now. A number of parishes is increasing constantly. Undoubtedly, it is St. Petersburg, which is the main center of Orthodoxy here. You can see the more important cathedrals and churches. The last what I want to say is to mention that in modern Russian society, more and more people are interested in Orthodoxy. It may be explained by circumstances of our life and a new view on our history.
Christianity clearly established itself with the indigenous peoples of this area, but it was also Judaism that arrived during medieval times and established itself on the eastern rim of the Baltic. It is this culture that found itself primarily in the cities, and so Warsaw, Riga, Kaunas, and Vilnius held large Jewish populations.
From the 15th century until World War II, the southern section of the Baltic region was the spiritual and cultural center of Judaism. During the 15th century, a surge of hostile actions directed at the Jews took place in Western Europe. In Spain, for instance, Jews and Moors were forced to convert to Christianity or face expulsion. Many of the Spanish Jews migrated to the Balkans, others to the Netherlands and Germany. But there, in the Rhine Valley, they were compelled to move east into Brandenburg, Saxony, and Silesia. Soon, they were required to leave these parts as well. However, Jews were invited to settle in Poland and Lithuania. In time, Jewish centers of learning and pious life started to flourish. In this setting, Yiddish developed into a distinct language. The Jewish presence was, however, not appreciated by all parties. Over the centuries, the Jews of Poland, Lithuania, the Ukraine, Belarus, and Russia were subjected to numerous pogroms. During the mid-17th century, one-third of the Jewry in Poland was killed and Jewish property destroyed in a peasant revolt. Whereas the Jewry in the West gradually assimilated and were accepted as citizens in the countries where they lived, this never happened in the East.
Although it is Gotland that is the meeting place in the Baltic, it is also Riga that is the meeting place of religions. It is the unique position of Latvia, both geographically and through its toleration of ethnic groups and cultures, that we have a wonderful cultural mix of both toleration and the richness of the society due to its variety of religions. So let's now go and take a look at this footage that has been made by our colleagues in Latvia to show what religion is all about in the cultural mix of the Baltic.
A traveler having come to Latvia will find here not only people speaking different languages, but also a unique variety of religious beliefs and confessions. The majestic Catholic churches, modest Lutheran, and colorful Orthodox and Old Believers churches are a harmonic part of our landscape. But in remote rural districts, you will find also the old pagan cult caves and cult stones. This religious diversity is a historic phenomenon caused by the geopolitical situation of Latvia. It has always been in crossroads of economic, political, and ideological interests of different powers. Latvia occupies a unique place in Europe with its well-preserved pre-Christian pagan traditions. In the 12th century, Eastern Baltic was the only pagan island in the Christian Europe. Although Latvia was Christianized in the next century, the pagan rites of the old Indo-European culture have been partly preserved till nowadays and have even influenced Christianity there. Catholic belief was first brought to Latvia and its western part, Kurzeme, by Danes in the 11th century. But at the end of the 12th century, the German merchants came there together with missionaries. Later on, Germans established several church states, bishoprics, and the state of Teutonic Order. They were altogether called the Land of Mary. For many centuries, the eastern border of the Land of Mary was also the eastern border of Catholicism in Europe. After the faith wars in the 17th century, Catholicism was widely spread just in the eastern part of Latvia, Latgale, belonging then to Poland. Even the genocide of Russian government against Catholic Church in the 19th century couldn't annihilate it. Nowadays, Catholics are the second largest confession in Latvia, after Protestants, remarkable for its religious and social activities. Today, Latgale is the most distant northern territory of the Catholic Europe. The Land of Mary in medieval times was part of the German Empire. It had especially close links with the northern Germany. That's why in the 16th century it was strongly influenced by Lutheranism. In the next century it spread also in Kurzeme dukedom and became dominant in Vidzeme, subjected to Sweden, that is, in the most part of Latvia, Such is the situation also nowadays. In ancient times, even before German conquest, Orthodoxy coming from Russia began to spread in eastern Latvia. It was adopted by some Latvian chiefs. Later on, during German, Polish, and Swedish rule, Orthodox parishes were situated mainly in cities, the members of the parishes being Russian, Belarusian, and Ukrainian merchants and craftsmen. In the 18th and 19th centuries, when Latvia was part of the Russian Empire, the spreading of Orthodoxy became an important part of state policy. Part of the Latvian peasants adopted Orthodox belief, hoping to improve their social position. Nowadays, also the newcomers, Ukrainians, Russians, and Belarusians, have joined the Orthodox community. Most of the Orthodox believers today live in Latgale. Latgale is also a unique old believers museum in Eastern Europe. Being persecuted in Russia, thousands of old believers found refuge there. They came to Latgale together with their families and formed a lot of old believers' villages. Due to the isolated way of life, their culture and customs have remained almost unchanged. A similar scene can be observed just in some remote old believers' villages in Siberia and North America. After regaining of independence, an intensive renewal and widening of all confessions is taking place in Latvia. Representatives of different nations are seeking their national as well as religious roots. After the hard years of Nazism and communism, also the Judaist parishes activize. They regain their old synagogues and build new ones. A small part of society, especially youth, joins other Christian sects which are not characteristic to Latvia, and even Krishna and Buddha doctrines. It was an especially uniting event when His Holiness Pope John Paul II visited Latvia and the Catholic center of it, the Roman Catholic Basilica of Agluona. His Holy Mass was attended by supporters of many beliefs. They understand more and more that despite differences in their beliefs, God is the same for all.
Well, religion is certainly spirituality as one aspect of it, perhaps the most important, but there is also an aspect of religion that has to do with culture, the way we express ourselves. And we will talk about culture for a little while, and let's start by asking Sven Olof, what is your comment? What is culture for you? Or,
well, I would like to stress upon one aspect of culture, the culture landscape. All the beautiful sceneries from Gotland or elsewhere in the region we have seen so far are in fact man-made, or at least affected by man. Not only the built-up areas, but the landscape itself. The natural forests are replaced by planted trees or removed to make arable land. The rivers and lakes are dammed, or the rivers are regulated for electrical power plants and so on. Moors and wetlands are drained for ditched for arable or grazing. Roads and railroads are forming a network connecting villages, towns, and cities. And this process, in fact, has been going on all since man claimed the land. When some land use were obsolete, or man left her village or settlement, there are some traits left behind in the soil. And I think the main task for the museums today is to investigate, interpret, document, and show the physical heritage in the landscape. But the process, which was once the most important to change the landscape, was, I think, Charles has some comments on that.
Yes, well, before the
before agriculture, we really can't speak of a cultural landscape. Agriculture was the very process of changing the natural landscape into a cultural landscape.
I think when we talk about culture per se, you have to take a look at what do you mean by culture. And those of you taking this course should be quite clear that there is no agreement whatsoever among social scientists as to what culture is. It's used quite differently as an explanation by the political scientists, by the economists, sociologists, anthropologists, etc. And lots of academic discussions take place as to what is culture. And if we use culture as an explanation, one of the things to remember is, are you willing to accept the fact that you behave the way that you do because of a culture? Are you willing to accept the fact that someone would say to you, why do you behave the way you do? And you would respond, well, it's because I'm Lithuanian or Estonian or Swedish or Norwegian. Is that sufficient of an explanation, or are there other variables? Are the variables also environment? Are they not also the linkage that we have today through communication systems, that we are all part of the same planet? Do we behave also because we're individuals? And as individuals, we make choices and decisions and meanings. And there's an entire field in social science having to do with meaning and reality. We construct it. And whatever reality we think exists, we pass on to our children, that they also be convinced that this is reality. And that has a lot to do with values and meanings. And I think that there's a new development in such a field, especially in Scandinavia, about meaning. It's called culturality.
Right. I'll say something about that. Yeah, but first I would like to say that one focus is that cultures confront each other in space and they precede each other in time. And this focuses on diversity, that you have different ways of solving similar kind of problems in different stages in history and in different parts of the world. But the concept of culturality focuses on something else. It focuses on mankind's or man's inherent need to create meaning, to make sense out of existence. And this is something that should unite, not divide.
Of course, and we've always tried to do something about what is it that we share in common as human beings? Do we share basic needs? What is this list of basic needs? I remember this has been a long tradition of research. Are basic needs food, shelter, clothing? Are they security? Are they love? And then what are the ways that a culture seeks those? And what is the wisdom of mistakes that then is passed on, because we not only succeed, but we also fail? And we take a look at the failures of this particular century with the wars that we've had and the divisions and cleavages in this area. And from that, we're looking to find out meaning and looking at this particular region and the developing of this region. And now we are looking for commonalities. Not only which king did what to whom in the 13th century, but also when did we actually share commonality, and
so
how did
one,
we make
one
it
thing
work?
To develop this is, of course, ask our students here who are actually coming here because they're asking for commonality. What's your point about culture? Do you have how do you see this? How do you see culture?
Oh, it's an interesting question. I can't discuss it from some theoretical point of view, but my personal experience shows that culture is quite common here in Baltic region. I'm coming from Lithuania, but now I've been studying here 1 year in Sweden, and I didn't discover some bigger difficult differences between the nations. Maybe some kind in food and some small things.
Yeah.
So it's nice to see that we are not so different as perhaps some of us used to think before. Yeah.
So do you mean you are playing the same rock music, or what is this part of the global culture that we have in common? That's what you're talking about?
Yes, but also if to look more to our Baltic region, even smaller things.
Yeah. There are so many aspects of culture. We could go on for the entire evening and just to talk about the various parts of culture. But I think we will look into one specific, because it's interesting in the Baltic region, and that is the kitchen, the culture. What we eat and what we drink is part of our culture and cultural patterns, certainly. Here we have some such food stuff from the medieval times, for example, the nuts. Please have some nuts. But we'll also look at what is still with us from these ancient days and that we are still serving. So let's go over to today's table.
Welcome to our table with many traditional dishes here from Gotland. And I will invite you to a real Gotland feast. I sit here with Lena and Anne-Marie, who know all about this. The pheasants have always had their own food here on the island since the prosperity in the Middle Ages. But since the 18th and 19th century, the pheasants have been more and more like the burghers in the city. But food is very traditional, so many old dishes have survived. So you can see a lot of them here on the table. Before the potato, bread played a much greater role than in our days. We still recognize this as pierogies in Russia and other eastern countries in Europe. And this kind of bread filled with meat and fish we also have here on Gotland. And we have had it since the Viking ages, so it's very old and very traditional. And what do we call it here on Gotland, Lena?
Ungstrul.
Yes, this delicious food is called ungstrul here, and it's a real Gotlandic pirog.
In northern Scandinavia, the traditional bread was baked for storing a long time. And this is tunbröd from the north. But in the rest of the Baltic area, we find levnad bread. And this is a typical rye bread. What did we call it?
Gotlandslimpa.
Yes, beer is known as the common beverage here in the Baltic region, and so also on Gotland. And of course, we can have it together with snaps, especially for the men. This beer here from Gotland is homemade, which is not common in other parts. And what do you call this kind of beer, Lena?
Gotlandsdrikke.
In the whole Baltic region, fish has been a very important foodstuff, especially the Baltic herring, which has been smoked or salted to be preserved. There is also the fermented herring, which today is an exclusive specialty in the coastal region of northern Sweden.
When it comes to meat, the great difference is between the north and the south of the region. In the north we have game from hunting, and in the south we have the pig and the mutton. And here on the table we have a head from mutton. It's roasted, and it's a specialty of this island.
Soups used to be a very common food. People didn't eat so much vegetables, but used them in soup together with different kinds of meat. Today, we don't eat soup, but we still eat pea soup and kaipsoppa, a kind of leek soup. It's special for Gotland.
Spices have always played a greater role in the south than in the north, and the spices were very precious, so they could only be at special feasts. And here on the table, we have a pancake. It's called a saffron pancake, and it's made from a recipe from the 18th century. And you see it here with mulberry. What a delicious dessert. Skål en bon appetit. Skål.
Vad menar du? Skål, Kurt. Thank you. So food is certainly part of culture, but another thing is jewelry and clothing. As you see, we are dressed up in these beautiful clothes. One part that is very special to the Baltic region is the amber. You see, I've got some amber here from the Kaliningrad district, actually. And we will see what they can tell us about amber in Kaliningrad.
Green, graceful pine trees are climbing up to the blue sky. They're like the ancient predecessors, which presented the world with wonderful stone amber. At the Kaliningrad region territory, the only in the world the amber plant is situated. Beaches, brooches, earrings emit the accumulated for many years warmth of many years. They gladdened the eye by their natural beauty. It seems that in these solidified teeth of ancient pine trees, the aroma of those remote times is retained. In perspective, it plans not to extend the extraction too much, but to pay the special attention to creation the art goods.
Amber could be found in nature just as it is and was used as jewelry long, long time ago. And this was also one of the first objects for trading in this region. And there are remains of this, of the finds that the archaeological find.
From this time, we have sophisticated amber jewelry, amber figurines from the East Baltic coast, because the collecting of amber and producing of amber figurines started about 6,000 years before our days. Inhabitants of Narva culture produced such a type of pottery, and they were well known in amber trading in the all East Baltic region.
Well, this is one of the first traces of trade, but of course, a few thousand years later, the trade started to develop in a very important way by using the rivers and the sea for communication and exchange of goods.
In ancient days, communications always followed water, the sea, rivers, lakes, and canals. This was the state of affairs from medieval times until the mid-19th century, when railways were constructed. Within a period of 50 years, a network of railways linking all the major cities and towns to each other covered the region. Railways sped up communications considerably and were important for industrialization and urbanization that started in the 19th century in Denmark, Germany and Sweden, and later in the eastern part of the region. Railways linked the major cities to one another, but did not follow ancient routes and thoroughfares. Rather, the railways were run through dense forests and across fenlands, often through regions where few people lived. With the railroads, a new kind of town emerged in the late 19th century, the railway junction, where lighter industries often would establish themselves. Motor cars developed early in the present century, but it was not until the 1960s that average employees of the West could afford the luxury of a private car. In the East, it is still not possible for most people. As the number of cars rose rapidly in the 1950s and 60s, roads were improved to accommodate for the increasing traffic. Once the major highways were laid with asphalt, a considerable amount of goods transport was transferred from railways to the roads. New urban environments grew up along the major highways. The most recent development is, of course, air traffic. Long-distance transportations has been sped up immensely. International airports are the news centers in a global network of communications. Around major airports, hotels, shopping centers, high technology industry, and vast parking lots are assembling. Basically, this still represents the same kind of process as when the trading places were established at river mouths in the ancient times.
Well, things sure have changed because now we no longer have to send a body with a person with a mouth to communicate. Now we can communicate via telephones, faxes, email, satellites, and we can communicate in ways that actually transcend the region that we're living in. The network of ethnicity is now tied in with a worldwide network of communication so that people all over the world can simultaneously and at the same time communicate and find out what's happening.
Well, the modern democratic state only fully realized during this present century. And it is very much about communication, it's about debate, it's about the free molding of public opinion. And for this reason, it might be interesting now to look at the formation of states, the process during which states in this region were formed.
Poland, Lithuania, Russia, Ukraine, Sweden, and Denmark are the oldest states in our region, dating back to medieval times. But to begin with, they were not states in the modern sense, with a given territory, a nation and a people speaking one and the same language. Ultimate power of the state was in the hands of a leader or king, sometimes elected, but often a son or a relative of those previously in power. The king should protect his territory and subjects, and he often wanted to enlarge his land by conquest and by marriage. But as long as roads were little developed, it was extremely hard for a king to govern a real vast territory. Also, therefore, our region long remained split into many small states. However, sailing on the sea was easier than riding on land. During the 16th and 17th centuries, Danish and Swedish fleets successfully controlled trade and cities around the Baltic coasts, and so they formed larger states. From the 14th century, first a Lithuanian and then a joint Lithuanian-Polish great power was established, this time not around the sea, but in the inland. But the king was seldom in full control of his empire. The most distant borders, far from the state's geographical center, were often contested. The birth of the modern state is often dated to the 16th century. At this time, new administrative and fiscal techniques and new weapons came into use, and with Gutenberg's invention of the printing machine began the formal development of the national languages, when a national edition of the Bible was printed. After the Reformation, the power of the king increased in the Protestant countries as he became head of a national church. And soon, in the 17th century, the ideal state seemed to be an absolute monarchy, with all power concentrated in the hands of the king. The democratic nation-state was born only about 100 years ago. And the sovereign of this state is now not a king or prince, but the people, namely all those who are citizens of the state. It is true that the state had always requested tax payments from its subjects, but it is only in the modern democratic state that the former subjects have become citizens, holding political rights. Now it is their representatives in the parliament who decide about taxes and the use of tax money.
So now when we have spent 1.5 hours trying to describe the origin of the Baltic region and the societies in the Baltic region, in what sense is it possible to talk about the Baltic region at all? I mean, this we have to ask ourselves because the region is rather more divided, has been recently, than united. So in what sense is this region? Sven Olof, you have a comment?
I would say from an environmental point of view, it's necessary to speak about the Baltic region. All the rivers, all the polluted rivers, for instance, coming out into the Baltic Sea, affects people living, for instance, in Little and Great Belt and the Öresund. All the waters from the rivers are affecting people all around the Baltic Sea. That's our fate for the future.
So we have to deal with environmental questions together.
Yes.
Well, there are certainly more questions. Charles, do you...
Well, yes. One important thing that the change now for the future is that the Baltic region is becoming a marketplace. And it's not only of an exchange of goods, of commodities, of materials. It's also a place where people meet. It's a meeting place where ideas and values and these sort of things are... they are
exchanged.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So in that sense, it's very important. There is a third aspect that's a sort of inescapable to regard the Baltic region as a region, as a unit, and that's the security aspect. We do have to create a secure future together because we're neighbors to each other. There is no escape from that. And so in that sense, we also have a region, at least in these three senses, environmentally, economically and trade-wise, market-wise, and security-wise. Lucia?
But I think you've got to talk about the underlying issues, and the issues always have to do with values. They have to do with, first of all, the development of human rights. You can't very well have security in neighbors if you don't consider each other human, and if you don't give each other the same values of human rights and jurisprudence. Mm-hmm. You also have within that the main issue of democracy. Are we going to be all free people to make choices and to discuss things, or are we going to be slaves in totalitarian systems? And I think this region has an enormous potential as a geopolitical grouping that was certainly very successful in the Bronze Age and the Hanseatic Age, was successful before World War II, and has a chance right now, so we're in the right time and the right place right now, to take a look at our commonalities and those things that we share, and de-emphasize those things that could lead to conflict.
And that is exactly what we are going to do in these eight sessions that's ahead of us. Now it's only seven sessions ahead of us, but we are going to talk about the security aspects, we are going to talk about democracy developing in the region, we are going to talk about human rights in the region, our common values. So please stay with us for another seven sessions over this entire year that's ahead, and you are welcome back, in no less time than 2 weeks when we will broadcast from Gdansk and talk about the history of the Baltic region. Welcome back. Thank you for this time.